This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Welcome to Dreamland. We've got an extra long show today. There are two guests. The first is John Vivanco, a remote viewer who's going to tell us some extraordinary things about Russia and aliens. And then we're going to be talking to John Hogue, who has identified one of Nostradamus' quatrains as possibly predicting the Notre Dame fire. And it's really interesting because this is not the quatrain that's been bandied about over on the internet so much in the past week or so, but it's quite fascinating, and I think that you'll enjoy listening to what John Hogue has to say about it. John Vivanco is a remote viewer. He's been a remote viewer for 20 years. He's going to tell you one of the most remarkable stories about this process that you have ever heard that involves black ops, 9/11, and all kinds of things. He has also gone beyond that and has worked with video from Russia that is among the very few videos that do appear to be actual alien videos. But what does it mean? And how can it be that they knew back then that they were being remote viewed from the future? And who did that? And what did they find? I'm very pleased to welcome John Vivanco to Dreamland. John, let's start at the beginning with how you got into this insane area of remote viewing.
Yeah. You know, it was 1995, and I had actually just graduated from art school with a degree in fine art. Wow, we got some static, huh?
Just keep going. There's nothing okay. We can do about it. And if we stop and try to start again, it'll just come back. Something else will happen.
So anyway, I was, you know, watching Nightline, Ted Koppel, and he brought up this program that was in the process of being declassified called remote viewing. And, you know, this metal plate in my head heated up. It's this
Listen, John, let's
insane.
Try to reset. Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay, let's try to reset the call because the static is intense.
Okay.
Okay, sounds folks, I, one thing about Dreamland, it's always something new is always happening. Folks, we're going to take a break. I'm going to save what we've managed to get so far, and hopefully when we get back with John, there will be a little less static, but probably something else will happen. We'll be right back. Good God. Okay, we're back. There was no break there. All I did was do a save. And folks, you can listen to all the static and all the stuff that's going on. And I have to admit that John is quite unusual. We often, as you know, on Dreamland have problems like this. But with John so far, it has been quite intense. At least the screen hasn't gone blank again so far. Okay, John, you were trying to tell us about your start in remote viewing. Why don't you go ahead, if you can, and pick up where you left off, if you can.
Yeah, it was you know, that 1995 era when the Stargate program was declassified by the CIA, and when they started to out it on TV news programs, it was literally that term psychic spy that got my head spinning, and I became obsessed with what that meant. Even though, you know, I hadn't even considered myself to be psychic up to that point. I had a Zen meditation, spiritual practice and whatnot, but I didn't care so much about psychic stuff. It was just that term. So I had to investigate. I investigated those, some of the classes and programs that popped up around that time, and they were just incredibly expensive. So I was able to cobble together bits and pieces on how to do it by talking to some people that I knew that were doing it. And I taught myself. It was not until about a year or so later, 96, 97, that I was formally trained in remote viewing. That time I had, you know, been trained in fine art as well, which is, you know, it's basically describing how light falls on a surface. And that is a physical artist, someone who represents things physically. And that translated to remote viewing for me as being a very physical remote viewer. And you find out, you know, I found out later on that not every single remote viewer views in the same way, because a lot of people, you think about the filters we have and the way we approach life and ourselves, and we approach from concepts and metaphors to explain the world around us, storytelling in a sense. But for me, it was very physical and visceral. And that, I found out, was a valued trait within the world of remote viewing. So I immediately got pulled into a think tank, a civilian think tank. This think tank employed me as a professional remote viewer. And then later on, I became director of operations and co-ran the think tank. We worked with a team of remote viewers, employed remote viewers, which is typically the way you work remote viewing projects. You never use one remote viewer. You use 4 to 5 for each project question that you're working on. And we worked with corporations, in the technology sector, doing future technology, trying to get patentable ideas from the future, as well as counterintelligence, counter-terror, other intelligence agencies, financial, entertainment. We had actually worked on helping a toy company develop an alien toy. They wanted us to remote view what a specific race of aliens played with. So, we did that kind of stuff. Stuff for entertainment and television as well, coming up with narratives and stories, kind of a hero's journey on something that happened out in the universe,
right?
An event, so we did
it's a funny thing about the universe. It's full of good stories, which people who are, one of the things about remote viewing is you can pick up amazing stories. And there are a lot of creative people out there who do not know that their right. stories are coming from actual events that happened on other worlds.
Exactly.
If you can learn how to cue into that, it's amazing how cool some of those stories are, because this is a big, complicated universe, and most intelligent species get in a hell of a lot of trouble, just like us.
Yeah, they do.
Listen, John, I'm gonna stop for a minute. We're gonna take another break. During that break, I am going to do a save on the show, so that if we do break down again, we will still have the show. Unless the computer just blows up in my face, which is always a possibility on Dreamland. We'll be right back.
Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge. If we watch, if we read, if we listen without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
They are found deep in a dying jungle, 6 infants. They aren't apes. They aren't human either, not quite. So, what are they? When they are spirited off to the United States, an incredible discovery is made. They are as smart as us, not human. The company that found them wants to buy and sell them as the most valuable animals on Earth, brilliant workers who need not be paid. Somebody has to stop this travesty, and that's where primatologist Beth Cook comes in. But can she stand up to the power and wealth that seeks to exploit them? Find out in Whitley Strieber's first standalone science fiction novel in 7 years. New. Get it on Amazon as an ebook or paperback.
You've probably heard the music for years. It's the theme song for Dreamland. But you may not know the name of the piece. The O of Pleasure. Or the name of the composer, Ray Lynch. Ray Lynch is a 3-time Billboard Award winner. Ray is also the composer of the platinum album, Deep Breakfast. Pandora calls Ray one of the most influential artists in New Age pop and adult alternative circles. For music that will move your heart and set your spirit soaring, visit www.raylynch.com.
The Afterlife Revolution is a work of love written across the bridge between the living and the dead, between me and my beloved wife, Anne. You can learn what it means to live across this bridge by reading or listening to the audiobook of The Afterlife Revolution. It's available in paperback, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook on audible.com, amazon.com, audiobooks.com, and wherever audiobooks are sold. We are back, I think. We're talking to John Vivanco, 20-year remote viewer who's had some extraordinary adventures in remote viewing, who is not well-liked by somebody out there. That's been very clear as we've struggled with doing this show. His book is The Time Before the Secret Wars. It gets into remote viewing and things like Zen, which we will learn a little bit about, because certain meditation practices greatly enhance remote viewing. His website, righthemispheric.com. You can learn how to get into contact with John on righthemispheric.com. John, you teach remote viewing, don't you?
Yeah, I teach it. I've been, you know, pretty much teaching it since a couple of years after I learned it. Formally teaching it. And there hasn't been one person that could not do it. So it's a skill that's accessible to every single human. And I think it's one that we have to develop for the future. There's all this talk about what's fake news, what's real news. Well, you know, if we could go inside of ourselves to understand what's truth and what's not truth, then we wouldn't have these arguments about fake news and real news. And that's where we have to go, because as a species, we're very manipulated, very, very much manipulated by those in power that want to control the narrative of things. So I think this is vital to our progression as a species. Absolutely.
Now, let's move forward to 911. And your company that you start, well, let's start first talking about the company and black ops and all that kind of stuff. How you got tangled up with that?
Well, so we were working with various intelligence agencies. We had handlers, a couple of different handlers within agencies. One of the agencies we had no handler in. While we were doing, you know, what we perceived as good work for some of these agencies, there was another one that was trying to shut us down. So one of the big things and scariest things that would happen were the break-ins to the houses. It was myself and my partner mostly that it happened to. Occasionally it happened to some of our viewers. Now, we were all decentralized, right, because the world of the internet, you can do that and work. So it was mostly the two of us that were getting harassed. And, you know, you go out, you go to the store, run some errands, you come back and your front door is open and your furniture's rearranged. Nothing's taken. It's just to say, hey, you know, we're in your stuff.
Just to let you know, yeah, I have that kind of thing happen all the time, too. My car getting screwed with or rumbled in some way.
Right.
Like I go out and the glove compartment's open and everything in the glove compartment scattered all over the car interior. And right. The hood is just a little bit open, which, I mean, you talk about making you a little paranoid. That'll work. Go ahead.
Yeah. Well, you know, one thing that we found was that the primary vehicle that they used, at least this is in Southern California, was a white pickup truck when they followed us and did these bumps, hit and runs. Bump you on the fender or on the bumper and then just take off.
I had that done to me about 6 weeks ago where a white pickup was hounding me while I was on the highway, 5 inches from my rear end, and the car in front of me suddenly stopped.
Yeah.
I was expecting something to happen because, you know, these white pickups are familiar to me too. I did hit, I just tapped the car in front of me, but whoever was there would have loved it if I had gone through that windshield. Go ahead.
Yeah, exactly. You know, and it's just this low-level harassment, and you never know when it's going to pick up into something more damaging. But it's typical to use the white pickups. They blend in, I guess. It's the most common car down there.
Yeah. Let me ask you this. Have you remote viewed the people who are after you?
Now, we did. We did do that. one of the issues that we had was, okay, so when you're working decentralized, so they're in your business. You know, they want you decentralized for one thing, because they can pick up all your communications and what you're working on. So a lot of that work we had to do sort of under the radar individually, so they didn't pick up that we were actually looking at them. I mean, I figure they knew that we would do that eventually. But so with remote viewing, the way remote viewers describe things is that, you know, they don't come up with acronyms, for instance. They describe things as opposed to name things, right? And that's why remote viewing is so accurate, ultimately. So what they describe is governmental black op type group and project. Now, when you think about, they didn't go out and specifically name an agency. But when you think about what the whole pretense and how remote viewing was declassified was running from the DIA, who was controlling the Stargate program. They handed it over to the CIA for the declassification of it. Now, the CIA are masters at social engineering, and they were the ones that wanted to control it as it's being spilled out to the public. So we were a wild card. We were a thorn in their side. We were civilians who just loved to do this, loved to do remote viewing. We had an investor invested heavily in our company. We had work, and we had media, a lot of media on us. So much so that we were gaining the spotlight, and they needed that to stop, to send it back to this controlled output. So the public perceived it in a different way, right? Maybe a little bit more boring. Maybe they can taper it off enough, because listen, you know, you can't go out and tell the public, hey, guys, we developed this amazing technology that will let you view anything in the world and look at all of our secrets.
Right? That's basically why they don't like remote viewers outside of the classified world, because right. What you're saying on this show is very toxic. It is that anyone can do this. It's not a talent. It's a learned skill. That is a problem, because not only is it a learned skill, when you really do learn it, you learn how to put your imagination aside. And that's real powerful, when you can tell the difference between something you're imagining and something you're really remote viewing. Okay, free Dreamlanders, listen up to these announcements and do what you need to do to keep this show going. You know, we're still at this point just about to hopefully get into the new website, but you can imagine how much trouble we've had doing that, given just what you hear on Dreamland. And so a donation on unknowncountry.com would be very nice, because our subscription system, as most of you know, has been broken. Old subscribers whose subscriptions run out for whatever reason can still log in. We can't do a thing about it. We can't get new subscribers, because the system does not take them, and we have had a number of experts and spent a lot of money trying to figure out what's wrong, and we can't. So if you want to make a donation to unknowncountry.com, do it, and also listen to these cool announcements about all kinds of nice stuff that is available. We'll be right back. We're talking to John Vivanco today, are trying to. So far, so good. We had a bad start. I lost the show. The screen of the computer started going blank. I've fixed that, I think. We had a little static. We fixed that. The static could have just been a coincidence. The other stuff was not a coincidence. John Vivanco's first time on Dreamland is a 20-year remote viewer. His book, The Time Before the Secret Words, his website, righthemispheric.com. That's righthemispheric.com. And you can engage with John on righthemispheric.com. It's a cool website, very nicely put together. And let's now go move ahead to the period of 9-1-1 and what you were doing then.
Yeah, it was so right after 9-11 happened. It had to have been a couple of days. We were contacted by the FBI. We had a relationship with them. it was kind of an interesting relationship because it bordered on being investigated. Well, we were investigated because it was a treasure hunting project we were working on, where we were actually set up to get involved in a project that let's say the treasure was on a national monument, and the client didn't tell us that and was enticing us and trying to get us to dig in a national monument.
Oh,
and
my.
Immediately. Yeah. Immediately after, so we didn't do that. We took off. Immediately after we left, the FBI gave us a phone call. And now this is immediately after. There's no way anybody would know that we were even on a national monument.
Right. And they were very nice and friendly and chatty.
Yeah, why don't you guys come in? We heard that you were digging in a national monument.
Remember this all of your lives. The FBI does not chat. It may sound like it's chatting. It is not chatting. Go ahead.
There's no tea time with the FBI.
No.
So anyway.
No. Those guys, those guys are very cool and they're very good at what they do.
Exactly. Yeah, I have some friends there. So they're okay. They're good guys. So, you know, we had a history with them, you know, not just other intelligence. And they contacted us just after 9/11. And the first thing they wanted us to do was to look at the retaining wall underneath the towers, because they were concerned that it was breached in some way, or it was going to be breached. And if that happened, the lower Hudson would just flood downtown Manhattan. So we had to look at the construction underneath there to find out if it was okay. And, you know, we came back with data that it was fine. It was not breached. It was not compromised in any way. So,
you know that's a very extraordinary remote viewing project, because look at a whole city was depending on you being right and knowing what you were doing.
Exactly. Right.
That's pretty awesome. That's
right.
Awesome.
Right. Yeah. So that was a nice win. They eventually were able to get engineers down there and confirm our data. And then they asked us to hunt for bin Laden using remote viewing, which we declined. Because, you know, one of the things we didn't want to do was have an errant bomb kill civilians because of our work. But we did say we can work on counterterror, future terrorist attacks on U.S. soil. So we started to work on that. You know, we would get tasked on a weekly basis, basically, for, a year or two on unfolding events. Now, at the same time, so I was really happy with this because, you know, up to that point, we had, obviously, we were being hounded by a covert agency, and we thought maybe this will help clear it up a little bit, but no, it didn't. It got worse, because what happened was it leaked to the media that we were, the articles that came out were psychic spies hunting for bin Laden, you know, and our company name was listed there.
Right.
That's a little scary for a lot of reasons, a lot of different reasons. I liked to be behind the surface back then and kind of hide and just do my work. But
one of the things about this field is this: even if you have no idea who the leaker was, and it was not anyone in your group, the fact that the leak was about you means you will be blamed.
Right. Exactly. And, you know, we had threats from, Al-Qaeda as well, publicly.
Oh, that must have been pleasant.
Yeah, that's the thing.
Nothing like a threat from Al-Qaeda to make your day.
Who should I be more concerned about at that time? This covert agency attacking and threatening to kill me, or Al-Qaeda? you know?
Right.
And meanwhile, I think I'm doing good for the country. Whether or not that was a false flag, which, you know, something's fishy around the whole thing, obviously, but it didn't matter because at that point in time, we're just on the ground running and trying to uncover future plots, whatever they may be. So the thing for me was, I was a little nervous about doing the media stuff, but I succumbed to handler if it was okay, because we were contacted by just about every single news show. Cause it's such a, you know, you psychic spies, right? I mean, how can you not get that kind of stuff on your news program? So we did interviews. I did stuff for CBS Sunday Morning and other news programs. Eventually what happened was, So we had an investor, and the investor was told specifically by a senator that you should not be doing this. You should not be funding them. This is a bad move on your part. And then the investor was blackmailed to pull out. Investor did not want anyone to know, and public information would have been public if this person kept going. So investor pulled out. You know, we were able to subsist somewhat on other projects we were working in financial realm stuff. But eventually what happened is that the covert group decided to go a little bit more heavily after our remote viewers, and we couldn't protect them. So it was okay for me to be harassed. I didn't, you know, I can deal with it to keep the good work going. But when it came to the viewers, and we just couldn't do it, you know? And so we had to shut the business down. After that, I began to work more in media because for me, what this came down to, I was living in a Zen center. It was a lay center. So I could actually live there and work outside, even though I never left because we were decentralized and I could just remote view there and run the business. I was meditating all the time, and I was remote viewing, and it really increases the ability, silences the mind.
Tremendously. Meditation, almost any kind of meditation, unless it's, you know, full of music and incense and
right.
Hopping around or whatever,
exactly.
Is going to intensify every type of psychic activity at all levels. And there's a nerve bundle between the two parts of the brain called the caudate and the putamen, and that nerve bundle grows if you're a meditator, and
yep.
that nerve bundle is critical to that. Those two parts working together are the intuitive area of the brain. So, you know, if you do that, you build your power, and that's exactly what you were doing living in a Zen center.
Yeah. You know, for me, it actually became this huge struggle of, you know, devoting my life to being monastic versus working in the world and in this sort of black and white either or sort of thing. And I was struggling with that because, you know, I thought I should just dump remote viewing and just live the monastic life to know the self, completely know the self. And it was this one moment where the teacher of the Zen Center said to me, John, in order to be the best remote viewer you can possibly be, you've got to let go of every shred of yourself. And it was that moment that I realized where these two worlds completely came together. And all I was doing was letting go. Because in order to get remote viewing data, you have to constantly, like layers of an onion, peel off your ideas about it. And it's the same thing when you are practicing sitting on the cushion to seek the self, to know what this moment is, to know what you are.
Right.
And it was at that point that it really came together for me as one complete holistic thing, and I didn't have to go anywhere or do anything, and I could do what I wanted to do.
You became a world walker.
Because it was all the same.
You became a world walker.
Right.
Yeah, that's what I am. I'm a world walker too.
Okay, yeah. Got it, yeah.
Yeah, a person who lives in the monastery but walks in the world. And
right.
In my case, the monastery is right here in my little apartment.
Exactly. So,
yeah.
Yeah.
Yours probably is too at this point, isn't it?
Yep, it's wherever.
Wherever you are, exactly. Your monastery goes with you. Folks, we're going to take another little break, and when we get back, we're going to completely shift gears because we're going after Skinny Bob. We'll tell you the whole story of Skinny Bob and what the remote viewing that has been done recently about Skinny Bob revealed, and what's so fascinating about the fact that Skinny Bob knew at the time that this remote viewing was taking place now, even though that was back in the 40s. We'll be right back.
Whitley Strieber became the host of Dreamland in 1998, and he's still the host today. One of the first podcasts, Dreamland has been built into the premier program of its kind, exploring the edge of science and reality. The show's archive on unknowncountry.com dates back to 2004 and contains nearly 700 episodes. Dreamland is a treasure unique in the world.
Normally, at this point in this ad, we say, help keep us on the air and go and subscribe to unknowncountry.com on the website, but you can't subscribe right now. What you can do is donate. You can go to our GoFundMe, just simply go to GoFundMe.com and search on Strieber, or you can donate on UnknownCountry.com via PayPal. Do it today. We sure could use your help. We're so close to getting the new site finished.
There are hundreds of charitable organizations in the world, but you have to have a sharp eye to be sure your money is going to where it's needed and not into the pockets of overpaid administrators. That's why Whitley Strieber and UnknownCountry.com support the Mercy Corps. It's non-sectarian, it's lean and efficient, and it goes everywhere on earth that people are in need. When you contribute, you can be sure that most of your dollar goes right to the homeless, the starving, and the desperate. Go to Unknown Country and click on the Mercy Corps Foundation ad on the left side of your homepage. A $10 gift can put food on a child's plate and shoes on his feet. Unknown Country and Whitley Strieber receive no compensation from the Mercy Corps.
Okay, we're talking to John Vivanco. We're going to be talking about aliens from here on out walking around on planet Earth. He has a way cool video on the internet called Remote Viewing the Skinny Bob Saga. You mustn't miss it. It is really interesting. There's 858,000 views on it for, 42,000 views on it for a reason. Just to remind you of the good stuff here, John is a 20-year remote viewer. He's got a book out that is way, way cool. It gets into all kinds of fascinating stuff, The Time Before the Secret Words. What is it about? Well, I'm going to let you look into it. Go on Amazon and take a look at it. And The Time Before the Secret Words, if you don't read anymore, well, try starting up again. It's worth doing because there's nothing like reading to get you real information, especially if it's not fake news. So be careful about that. His website, righthemispheric.com. That's righthemispheric.com. You can find out a lot about John. You can engage with John on righthemispheric.com. Okay, John, let's start at the beginning of the Skinny Bob saga.
Yeah, that was an interesting one. You know, we view a lot, do a lot of projects. And I got to say, this is, you know, one of the most interesting ones as far as viewer experience goes. One thing that happens when you remote view other beings is that, well, you know, beings that have sort of this fourth dimensional, well-developed fourth dimensional aspect to them and not just completely stuck in the third dimension with their brain and language, is that they will take notice of you when you view them.
I've noticed that.
Yeah, I'm sure you have. You know, and I've had encounters where things have showed up at my house after I viewed them.
Yeah, let me ask you this: have you had any bilocation related encounters? For just out of curiosity,
you mean going
where something
to where
shows
they
up
are?
That is not there but there, that's physical but not there?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, that is really really scary, I think.
Yeah, it is. It's funky. I mean, we had one project where I was visited a couple weeks afterwards, and they just literally showed up in my house. But yeah, and that's a story for another time. That was really interesting, a line that we went on.
Yeah, I don't
want
the screen to go blank again. So let's.
Yeah, exactly.
I can tell from your tone of voice that you're afraid that might happen. So I am too. So let's go back on Skinny Bob. Come on.
Yeah, let's get on Skinny Bob here. So Skinny Bob, you know, this interesting video looks pretty legit. I know a lot of people argue about it being CGI. They still argue about it being CGI. Now, I take remote viewing data running with a team of remote viewers and doing analysis on it as a very, very accurate method to understanding the truth and reality behind it. So,
well, before we go on, let's explain where the Skinny Bob video came from. First, when did it first appear? And then we're going to ask you what it is.
Yeah, it first appeared on the internet probably in around 2010, in that whole time frame, I think, 2012. By a Russian guy. Now, it's supposedly a leak from Russian intelligence, and it shows in a couple of different clips, first a UFO flying around, then a UFO on the ground with some bodies that look like the gray-style alien, big head, big eyes, and then it shows the physical functioning of a gray moving around, and then also a group of grays walking. So we have five different clips that are strung together here. And the thought is that this actually comes from U.S. intelligence, and the Russians got hold of it somehow, and that they are now leaking it. And, you know, this video sat under the surface for a while.
That it comes from U.S. intelligence, that's not video that was originally made in Russia.
Right. That is the thought on it. Now we couldn't figure that out when we viewed it because we didn't look at that aspect. But yeah, it's believed to be. That's the rumor underneath the surface, as opposed to the Russians actually capturing the film. So you know what we did was we, in order to understand if something is real or not, we want to understand the subject known as Skinny Bob, so that we can figure out if this is maybe a human in a costume, or if it's some type of CG computer graphic simulation, or anything else, right? Or something that is non-human. So the way we task the remote viewers on things will bring out the reality of it instead of the story that somebody has concocted behind it. And what we found right out of the gate was that this was a real-life EBE, extraterrestrial biological entity, as opposed to somebody in a suit or computer graphics.
Yeah, you know, I had this video looked at years ago when it first came out by some specialists. And these beings, the little gray ones that you see briefly, that sort of with the round eyes and the kind of featureless skin, could be anything. But
right.
The ones that have features and look sort of humanoid, they are the real deal, and they are why, incidentally, there were rumors out there that the Roswell aliens were children in disguise, because they look sort of childlike, only
right.
with these big heads. And if you look at the way the anatomy works, these are probably not CGI images. They're
right.
probably real, and
right.
and they're not masks or anything like that. And so that leaves people who are not built like us walking around in these videos.
Right, exactly. You know, this is what we found. This is the really telling thing was when, so the viewers are describing it. Now the viewers all work blind. They don't know what they're viewing beforehand. So they can't, you know, make anything up, right? They have no idea. But all the viewers started going into, well, this is a extraterrestrial gray-type entity. Whether it is or not, I don't know, because that form seems to be somewhat ubiquitous throughout the universe and probably a good physical form for certain environmental conditions. So, you know, this being was well aware that the viewers were viewing them. And what happened was, so the first, you know, the first, I'd say three or four times, we were able to get in and we were able to do what we call consciousness maps on this subject. And the consciousness map is where this being started communicating with us, the viewers, while we were doing it, because, you know, we go into the mind of the subject. And it started to say stuff like, get out of here, you're bugging me, leave me alone. It was bordering on being depressed because of its condition, a situation that it was
yeah,
in.
Yeah, well, if you were on another yeah. planet, especially a primitive planet, and couldn't get home.
Yeah.
I think depression would be one thing that you would feel.
Yeah. You know, I've had experiences growing up with, I don't like to call it abduction because, you know, I think we're all involved in it to a certain degree in agreements, but, you know, taken. And I'm not too fond of them, but I became fond of Skinny Bob after this because of this emotional quality that this subject had. And what happened was, so we knew that we were the first viewers to ever view Skinny Bob because we were able to get in. It wasn't until about three or four sessions in and sending other remote viewers in to view the subject that Skinny Bob started bouncing the viewers. Now, when we view these beings, there's no time, right? Time doesn't exist. Time exists for us in our little continuum here, but outside of that, time doesn't exist, and time doesn't exist for remote viewers. We actually go to the event, the moment, when it was happening. So we were back there in the 1940s when that was filmed with Skinny Bob. And so Skinny Bob was getting annoyed of these viewers constantly going in and started to bounce them and send them to other scenes, like, you know, like a peaceful little boat floating on a lake. And the viewers will just like start describing, well, there's a boat and there's a lake and there are hills. And it's nothing to do with Skinny Bob anymore. And after that, it was difficult to get in and get any more information. But I think, you know, we've gotten enough on his condition to know that this is something real. This is something that happened. You know, we even went and basically went to where Skinny Bob came from. And we did get this planet within a third dimensional, somewhat crossover, third to fourth dimensional astral plane. It exists basically in both realms, like Skinny Bob does. Planet with full of crystalline substances, very white, very mountainous, but white and crystalline structures that they use for data storage, communication. They use it for travel. They use it for all sorts of different things.
Yeah,
which
you'll
is really
find
fast.
It inside their machines too.
Right, you will. Yeah, yeah. So, you know, it was one thing I find interesting is that I know a lot of people out there aren't convinced or not by remote viewing, but you find, you know, a lot of the comments that people put on the YouTube around this Skinny Bob is still arguing about it is CGI. But it is interesting to me because even when people are presented with remote viewing data, which I take as 99.9% correct, to a certain degree, they still go back to, you know, what their own experience tells them. And this is the huge issue with regard to this type of work and trying to bring the reality to people to show them what's real and what's not real. And this is why it's like, I believe everybody should be learning this skill, you know, because this is the way that our species moves forward. We have to do this. We've got to do this. Instead of arguing in these highly conceptual language zones about things, we can move into a different area in our body and understand the truth and reality of anything.
Yeah.
So.
So the result of this is, though, that one of the problems is we can't get a hard fix on remote viewing unless
right.
it is confirmed in the physical world. And when you're remote viewing something like this, there is no way to get a hard fix. So people have to just think that what, you know, they have to kind of come from where they are inside
exactly.
as to what they want to believe of what you're saying.
Right. Well, you know, here's a really interesting thing. So it didn't matter who we were working with, whether that was a CEO, and we often did work with CEOs because they didn't want anybody else to know that they were employing us. And, you know, we'd have our meetings, we'd guide them through stuff in order for them to make more money, better products, whatever. But at the end of the day, sitting around drinking a beer, having a glass of wine, what do they want to know about? Aliens. That's it.
Everybody.
They want to know about aliens. They want to know about esoteric stuff. What have you viewed on this? What have you viewed on that? So it's really fascinating. And that's what actually shifted me, you know, more out of this corporate world into showing people areas of high strangeness, the narratives around them, things like Skinny Bob, uncovering what's in their own environment. The mysteries are around us constantly, you know? And so this is what gets people really excited to want to learn it. And it's been this amazing and fascinating journey up to this point where I'm currently just doing expeditions, you know, remote viewing locations of high strangeness and, going out on expeditions to, see what we can uncover and film.
What do you define as a location of high strangeness?
Well, you know, typically, it's got to involve a multitude of phenomena across the board. So if you look at an area like Mount Shasta, you've got missing people under strange circumstances. You've got apparitions that seem almost religious showing up. You've got legends of Lemurians. You've got legends of giants, UFO sightings, et cetera, et cetera. So when I find locations that have a lot of those types of things, we set out to remote view what's happening there on various levels,
yeah,
and then go out and film. So, for instance, you've got Mount Shasta. We take that. I got caught up there for a while. We were looking at the J.C. Brown story. I don't know if you know this guy.
Yeah, tell us.
Yeah, he was a geologist. 1902, he was hired by a mining company to go search for gold in the Cascades. And so, you know, he set out, and his claim is that he found this cave with a rock pile in front of it. And he went down this cave for about 11 miles, where he eventually came to, yeah, right? So he's, you know, he was in 1903. He's got probably gas lamps and whatnot, making his way, probably spending days in this cave. And he made his way deep into this mountain where he found a series of rooms that he called the village. Within these rooms, he claims to have found giant mummies. So mummies that were 8, 9, 10 feet tall. And some of these mummies were dressed in what he called royal garb. And he thought, he also found hieroglyphs. He found all these symbols on shields and plates and spears, all sorts of stuff. So he comes out of this, you know, he thinks he's made this huge find, these mummies that are, you know, up to 11 feet tall. He spends the next 30 years investigating, trying to understand what he's found. And he shows up in Stockton, California. He's in his 70s in the 1930s. Now he's wrangling together a search party for about a month in Stockton. And this is how we know of the story, because he didn't publicize it until that time. And you can find this story in the Stockton newspaper. You can find it online. So he was getting a search party. They'd meet once a week. He wanted to go and take all these people to the cave. He had 80 people. Some of these people had quit their job. He was going to show this to the world. You know, he thought he found the lost civilization of Lemuria, right? After he had investigated, you know, he went on the writings of Madame Blavatsky and James Churchward and believed that these beings had come over from the sunken continent of Lemuria. And, you know, it's part of the whole mythology surrounding Mount Shasta these days, of these beings that live in the mountains. So the day before they're to go, he disappears. He's gone. No one sees or hears of this guy ever again. Now, he didn't take any money. He claimed he was a millionaire, so he didn't need any money. He just wanted to run the expedition up and get this place surveyed, shown to the world. So we looked into well, we wanted to know if this is true or not. Did he find what he found? And the way we task things with remote viewers, our data came back as absolutely a definite. The data that we got were exactly what he was describing in his stories about it, and then some. In fact, that whole cave complex is full of giant mummies. And, you know, when you get into the whole idea of giants, there are loads of stories of these that came out in the early 1900s across the U.S.
Oh, yeah.
People digging up giants in those Indian mounds, right? And you run into Native American stories of giants battling with giants. So, you know, there was a time when everybody believed in giants until it was socially engineered out of us. So anyway, you know, we found that it was true. And then we also found that J.C. Brown was murdered. He was abducted and he was murdered the day that they were, the day before they were supposed to head up.
Now, there has been a skeleton of a giant found in, I believe, Oregon.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's not a controversy anymore. But you mentioned social engineering again, and why is this stuff? I can understand why there's social engineering around remote viewing, because it's anyone can learn it, and the last thing the people who use it behind the scenes want is that for anybody to be able to do it. And not only can you learn it and do it, nobody can stop you going anywhere you darn well please. You just have to get, if you know what kind of locations to where you need to go, you can find out amazing stuff and they can't stop you.
No, they can't.
No,
they can't.
And they also can't stop people from other countries like China and Russia doing the same thing.
Right.
So, I mean, at this point, there's all kinds of remote viewing running around on this world, on this planet, because the three great powers all do it. The French do it. The British, I think, might do it. I've never heard anything direct about that, but,
The cat's out of the bag.
Yeah, exactly. The cat is out.
And
they don't want the cat to get out of the bag and into the public. It's fine if the cat gets to China and Russia. The cat,
right.
I mean, the cat actually started in Russia, but that's another story. The problem is public empowerment. That's what scares them.
Right. Exactly. But, you know, I think that for the evolution of our species, if we're to survive, I think this is vital. You know,
we have to have new tools. Because right now, this planet is in a tailspin, and unless we figure out new tools, we ain't going to make it, basically.
Right. Well, you know, we had this gray alien that would come around and give us information. This was back in the day of when we had the company. When you get involved in remote viewing, the craziest stuff happens. It's just mind-bendingly weird stuff. And like your life, Whitley, I mean, you understand this. But we had this being that would show up on a regular basis giving us information, claiming that there was going to be a massive event in the future. And the development of remote viewing and telepathy was absolutely vital because that would be the only way that we'd be able to communicate. You know, the whole thing of this massively destructive event happening in the future. Honestly, I don't think we're going to run into that at this point. Which is interesting. It's almost interesting how it's almost like timelines have shifted and changed on us over the years and moved us away from horribly destructive things. I don't know if you've been getting the same kind of information, but it appears that way.
Well, you know, to me, the most dangerous weapon in the world right now is just climate change denial, because, when you look at what's just gone on in the past 6 months on this planet, obviously it's in upheaval already. And this is just the beginning. So, I mean, you look at, for example, the Middle East, the whole so-called Arab Spring, when I heard that word Arab Spring, I thought, boy, these people are playing with themselves. They have no idea what's going on in the Middle East.
No.
Because it started with a famine, with the fact that bread prices went crazy because there was a big drought in the Ukraine and Russia, southern Russia, and they couldn't get enough wheat. The Russians they and the Ukrainians closed off wheat exports because they, their own people needed it. So the result of that was that people began to go hungry, and that one guy in one of the countries burned himself to death on the street corner when the police wouldn't let him sell fruit to make money. And that started the whole thing. In other words, it was a climate change issue.
Right. I see what
you,
yep.
You see what I'm getting at?
Yep.
And
yep.
We are still struggling with that. And now we're having all these horrible immigration problems all over the world. And, you know, I'm not necessarily a Trump supporter or against Trump, but he's not wrong about the fact that this country is being overwhelmed by immigrants and people coming up across the border, and it's going to get worse, not better.
Right.
Absolutely.
Yep, exactly.
And it's a huge humanitarian crisis because the Mexicans can't handle them either. There's too many of them. The whole of Central America could walk out in the next 10 years because of the collapse of the local environment. That could happen.
Right. Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
Well, anyway, we got off on a subject that nobody wants me to talk about, and I don't blame them. I'm sure you'll send me angry emails, and that's okay. I don't mind. If I minded angry emails, I would stop doing this a long time ago. Okay, well, listen, we're getting moving toward the end of the show. We've got about 10 minutes left, and I want to know where you are now. Like, I was so curious to why did you decide to remote view the Skinny Bob in particular?
You know, it's one of those videos that when I first saw it was extremely enticing as far as the potentiality for evidence goes. I mean, there's a lot out there, and you can find it if you look for it. But it was so interesting, the movements of the character there, that we had to view it. You know, we had to look at it. And I don't, like, for one thing I like to do is put videos out where I do expeditions. But this one is basically data-driven, where I'm just presenting the data on it, because I found it so incredible and so interesting. And so legit, especially when it came to the remote viewing side. And you can see in the video, in the remote viewing data, that the narrative, unpacking the narrative and how Skinny Bob felt and what was going on with him was so, you know, it was just so almost heartbreaking.
It is hard. I agree with you. And I think that's... As I said, I think there's something true to that, because how would you feel if you were in his position?
Right. You know, so the viewers were describing, one viewer in particular was describing this somewhat like the Planet of the Apes. You know, the whole narrative around that is, you know, humans get stuck on the Planet of the Apes. Well, this is how Skinny Bob felt. You know, he basically got stuck on the Planet of the Apes, and he's destitute about it. Just a horrible situation for him. And that was, you know, ultimately why I really wanted to get this video out, because, you know, there's, where is that, like, direct one-to-one relationship on a deeper experience of what these beings are? We have a lot of different beings that are coming here. There's gazillions of beings out there. But these beings have interacted specifically with humans. And I think people want to know, what's their psychology? What's going on? What happens when they're put in a bad situation? What happens? Do they get upset? Do they have emotions? To a certain degree, some of them do. Some of them don't. But, you know, I think that's important stuff to know about. And I think there's a lot more that we can do, that I can do, on exploring that with remote viewing.
I think there is, too. And, well, like, for example, they were here. And what happened to Skinny Bob? Do you know?
He eventually died. He eventually left this the physical world, you know.
Yeah, because they don't die quite like we do.
Right, exactly.
I mean, they do die like we do, but they know it and we don't.
Right.
Not until it actually happens.
Right. It was basically almost being heartbroken, that kind of a feeling. You know, there was this other aspect of it where it was his purpose, it was his path. In doing this, because this created the link, the connection with humans to a certain degree. that could lead to future contact with the rest of their species. And so when you look at this video and you see these three beings, so first you see Skinny Bob, and then you have later on in the video these three beings walking, that is a contingent of beings that came afterwards, later. So establishing this link of working together, and that's when they came in. So Skinny Bob had been deceased by then, though.
Yeah, it does it still go on?
It still goes on.
They came here, they kept coming back.
Yeah, they kept coming back.
Or
now,
maybe
I
they've
know.
Been here for many, many, many thousands of years. We don't even know that.
Well, you know, I mean, think about the Earth here. We're this is an amazing place as far as products and food sources and whatnot, if we don't pollute the hell out of it and destroy it. But, you know, this is can be considered somewhat of an outpost where these, you know, at least ones in the three-dimensional realm can utilize, come here, establish connection base, get supplies, move on to explore and expand themselves, their race, because that's what it's all about. And that's what we saw in this data, is that they're coming here to get materials. That's what they're interested in. And they, you know, we're the squatters here at the same time, right? You know, we're the ones that basically have right claim to this. And, you know, if there is a just universe and they do follow certain rules and protocols, then, you know, they would come to at least the government, no matter how secretive they are in keeping it from us. They would at least go through them in order to get that type of permission, whether they needed it or not, you know. And that's what we found. They're out, you know, the survival of their race for them is the most important thing. So, you know, they're out figuring out how to do that. And it's just ongoing.
Yeah, they're
thing.
Out for themselves, of course.
Right. Right.
Well, it's ultimately. Not like we wouldn't be for
right.
ourselves.
Right.
In fact, if we ever get off of here in any big way, we are going to be out for ourselves. We're going to be out there in the universe looking for stuff that we want and for things we need. We're not necessarily going to be going to other planets and telling them how to come here and get our stuff.
Right.
You know, we might think in terms of trade, but that is a very iffy subject because of the huge disconnects between one place, one group of people and another. You know, they have different powers and different meanings even than we do. So it's hard to think that sort of what we think of as conventional trade, where, you know, we buy their cool electronics and they buy our cool electronics in return, is actually going to work.
Right, exactly.
It's totally irrelevant, probably, I would think.
Yeah, I know.
Well, listen.
Swapping cell phone technology.
John, I'm so pleased that you came on to Dreamland. I think it has been a really good show. And folks, you can click through to his video on YouTube from the Dreamland show page, as always, when we have a video connected with the show. And so if you're listening on YouTube, go to unknowncountry.com, click on Dreamland, and you'll find a link there. Or, John, what do they search on YouTube to get to it?
Right hemispheric remote viewing.
Right hemispheric remote viewing, and you'll get right to it. Great. Okay. Righthemispheric.com is his outpost on this planet's internet. His book is The Time Before the Secret Words. It's been awesome. It's really been a good show, and I certainly have enjoyed it. I'm so glad my computer is not yet burned down. I'm glad we got through all of the hassles at the beginning. They finally gave up
too.
On us.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much. It's been great. And you got to come back. We're going to want to hear more from you.
Anytime. I'll be there.
Okay.
All right. Thanks, Whitley.
Next up, John Hogue on Notre Dame and Nostradamus. Did he prophesy this or not?
Whitley Strieber has published an incredible 2-volume historical novel called In Hitler's House under his open pseudonym Jonathan Lane. This amazing story follows the life of William Weber, who meets Hitler while touring Germany in 1931 and becomes his friend and confidant, but then, when he realizes the truth, becomes a spy in Hitler's house for the Allies. Living a life of terrible danger, he falls in love with another of Hitler's secret friends, also a spy in his house. This is a story of espionage and desperate love and the deepest portrait of Adolf Hitler ever created. Don't miss In Hitler's House, available in paperback and as an ebook on Amazon.
John Hogue is with us. The Notre Dame fire, there's a huge meme on the internet as to whether or not it was predicted by Nostradamus. Well, if there's one person in the world who knows the answer to that question, it is John Hogue. John's website is hogueprophecy.com. John is now doing online readings again, and he'll tell us a little bit more about what he's doing in just a moment. But it's exciting stuff. There's also a free newsletter at hogueprophecy.com. And you can get involved with John's work. And remember, when it comes to Nostradamus, I think John might be the only researcher out there who actually speaks and understands, perhaps doesn't speak, but at least reads medieval French, the French that the quatrains were actually written in. Is that correct, John? And John, welcome to Dreamland.
Well, thanks for having me back, Whitley. And yes, that's correct. I mean, I can read it carefully and slowly, and I've been literally created my own database called, I call it my Nostra Dictionary, that looks at everything. I created it about 20 years ago, and it looks at everything, every kind of way, all the polyglot of languages that Nostradamus used, specifically a Latinized 16th century Renaissance French with a lot of medieval Moyen Francais in it, medieval French. And so I very carefully go over every word and also think of the things of being that I'm also a poet. It's, most people forget that Nostradamus' verses in their original 16th century French are rhymed.
Right. They're poetry, really.
They're poetry. And, yeah. And so one has to bring in the metaphorical, but one has to do it. The second important thing is one has to spend decades learning how people in the 16th century thought.
Yes.
And how they felt. What were their phobias? What were their projections? Because, you know, Nostradamus is a human being, but he's what the most of the interpreters out there I see are running the conceit of always looking at Nostradamus' prophecies as if he was a 21st century man, but he's not.
Right, and this is so critical. And by the way, folks, those of you who are just starting to listen to Dreamland, we have a lot of new listeners on YouTube and various places on Alexa. John has been with us many times over the years. Normally, John gives us prophecies in January, and then we talk about them again in June. We go over them again in June. But this is a sort of John Hogue special, because obviously something extraordinary and terrible happened, and it seems to be somehow connected with Nostradamus' prophecies. John, tell us, why don't you, why you got started with Nostradamus in the first place? You know, in all the years you've been coming on Dreamland, I don't think I've ever asked you that question.
Yeah, I don't think you have. And it's been like, what, quarter century or something? It's
You're one of our longest term guests.
Well, I guess it's time. Basically, first moment I experienced Nostradamus was in middle school, trying to take a nap after lunch in what I thought was going to be a boring documentary in social studies class. So the lights were down. I put my head down on my school table, and then it was called The Crooked Cross, and it starts off with this the famous, infamous shot of Goebbels and all the kids and the Hitler Youth burning books. And then the narrator says, 400 plus years before, a man named Nostradamus. And I heard that name, and I immediately shot up, ramrod straight my spine. It just kind of leaped up off the table, my head. And the first thought I had, my first thought about Nostradamus was, that's the strangest name I've ever heard.
Yeah, I agree. That was going to be my next question. What does his name mean?
Well, here's where it kind of ties into why the memes are so strong. Nostradamus is the old 16th century spelling of Notre Dame. Notre Dame de Paris, it means Our Lady of Paris. That is literally the name of the cathedral. because the French in medieval and Renaissance times used to have a slang, a colloquialism, that was that if you were saying, I'm going down to pray at Our Lady, that told everybody you were going to take a walk down to the cathedral. So here is a Jewish family that came out of the first diaspora out of Spain at the end of the 1300s, not the famous Spanish Inquisition diaspora. And they end up through southwest France, they come to Provence, and they settle down. And then before Nostradamus was born, the family was Christianized so that they could stay in Provence and not be thrown out because a new anti-Semitic French king was crowned, and he gave them the choice. So they took on the name of basically unusual because there's not a lot of people who do this. It's like my Michel de Nostradam in English translation would be Mike Our Lady. it's like Mr. Our Lady.
Yeah.
So it is a unique name similar to the unique name of Napoleon, which is another French figure that he even talked about. Paul Ney-Laurent, he called him in an anagram, which spells out actually the Corsican original spelling, which is more Italian, Napoleone, Napoleonois is what it means, Napoleone the king. So anyway, it's with everything that happened. I mean, I thought I was only going to write a brief article about it, but I've been spending the entire last week on the case, and now I have three very interesting articles that I hope to produce in the next 48 hours. But I had to play reporter, and I had to go deep into my French sources, listen and translate some very interesting interviews with a man named Benjamin Mouton, who is, there's another funny name, it means mutton,
yeah.
Sheep, Benny Sheep. So he is, he used to be the chief architect of the overseer of the cathedral. He retired in 2013. He was there 13 years. He's very respected, a very earnest man. And I watched him on LCI TV, which is their all-time news, 24-hour station in France, and Canal 1, I think. But anyway, I watched him, and he has divulged a lot of very interesting things that indicate that something really went wrong with either the security, with either the fact that the fire did not actually happen in a workspace, that the wiring of Notre Dame had been completely upgraded during his watch, so to the highest standards because of the dangers. The fact that oak that old is so dense and hard as a hard wood that it would take an intensely powerful accelerant to get it to a heat where it would get into a what I now call, because I hate this phrase, positive feedback loop, so I call it positively destructive feedback loop, where, and I used to be a bush fireman and was also trained a bit as a volunteer fireman, so right. I know that at a certain point when you have a critical mass of heat, it doesn't matter how hard your wood is, it's going to burn like we saw. But the key is, how did it start so suddenly and so explosively? I mean, when you see the early parts of the fire, which I caught just as it was happening, there were hundreds of foot-high flames coming out from under the spire. I've been to Paris. I know the scale of what was going on there. I've been in Notre Dame. And Nostradamus also had a great... He loved Notre Dame. He stayed at the Hotel Notre Dame next to it when the first time he went to Paris to have his audience with the king and queen, who wanted him to explain a prophecy that might have been hinted that the king was going to die in a jousting accident, which he did 4 years later. And that was the prophecy that made Nostradamus famous to this day. He was probably very frightened and praying a lot in Notre Dame the night before when he got to Paris, because he commented to his publisher on his way through Lyon to Paris. It took like a month to get there on the royal livery. They even gave him royal horses. He was afraid they were going to, he was going to lose his head. So I imagine he had a difficult night praying at Notre Dame in the night mass. So there's definitely a connection to the building by name and by experiences. And he was attached to it.
We're going to have to take a very brief break here for our free Dreamlanders. Remember, Contact in the Desert is coming up soon. I'll be there. Linda Moulton Howe will be there. All kinds of people. It's a huge thing. Just Google Contact in the Desert, and you'll get right to the program. It's May 31 to June 3 in Indian Wells, California. I'm going to be talking about UFOs in my free lecture, which is something I rarely do, but I have a lot of knowledge of this. And second, my main lecture will be about A New World, Alien Contact, A Miracle Denied, my new book. We'll be right back. The Afterlife Revolution is a work of love written across the bridge between the living and the dead, between me and my beloved wife, Anne. You can learn what it means to live across this bridge by reading or listening to the audio book of The Afterlife Revolution. It's available in paperback, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook on audible.com, amazon.com, audiobooks.com, and wherever audiobooks are sold. We're talking to John Hogue, his website, hogueprophecy.com. John is once again doing online readings. And you might check that out. I think it's going to be, it's an interesting thing. John, can you tell us a little bit about what you're doing?
Yeah, it was a strange thing that happened back in 1992, when my work kind of exponentially became more vast. And I had to deal with this sudden awakening of empathy that is really the fuel of the way, the accelerant of how I do readings. I had to actually be one with the world and feel it, all its happiness, all its sadness, all its fears, all its hopes and its unconsciousness and the hope for enlightenment, all of that. And I was really struggling with that. It was like being overwhelmed. And one of the things I did at that point was I stopped doing readings, which I had mostly done divination readings with tarot. I used to use the old original edition of Crowley, then the Dakini Oracle. And then I had bought a copy of my friend Padma's Osho Zen Tarot decks, and I remember watching her in Pune in the ashram of Osho where I lived. I watched her paint these cards and create them, and I never actually used them because I decided not to read anything but the world. And I felt like I was never coming back to it. Over the next 26 years, a lot of people were saying, when are you going to get back to private readings? And I said, well, keep in touch. I don't think I ever am, but I don't do this by closing any doors. If I'm to do it again, existence will provide me the signs that it's time. I don't even know what those signs are, but I trust. And therefore, and if you're in a space where you trust that if it never comes back, that's fine. If it comes back, that's fine. And then in September of last year, it came back. And I went to Little Rock and did readings at the Arklantis convention and to see what would happen. And it became this amazing new way because I have 26 years of experience now as a world reader. And now there's no difference. I read the person before me online. Or in person. Sometimes I show up in person for readings, and so I can always notify people at Hogue Prophecy. But I have come in contact, for the most part, with some amazing people who it seems like most of the people are being called by this energy who are at a crossroads in their life.
It's odd that you say that. Everybody is saying that to me.
Yeah,
it's amazing.
There is something going on
in that respect in this world, for sure.
Well, it is definitely there's it's a personal reading, but the bigger picture is also embraced in my readings. I mean, there are some significant changes happening that are showing an acceleration of climate change, which has brought the potential of extinction level event far closer now than I. It was always in the distance. Now
it's not anymore. No,
it's literally in the next 30 years. If we don't, and this is, I stress, if we don't change the way we exist here, and how, and redefine, as I've often said on your show, every year we go deeper in the 21st century is going to be a clarion call for human beings to redefine what it is to be human from the top to the bottom of all of our beliefs, religions, politics, finance, consuming, everything. And it is definitely calling us louder and louder. And so therefore, people are beginning. I mean, there's one positive thing about such a dire time we are entering. And I'm going to produce a book at the end of the year, which, because of my caregiving with my mom, it was delayed to a point that now it's evolved into a far better book. And it's a book called The Roaring 2020s. And it's
wow.
And it's, I don't do biannual or annual prophecy books. It's my farewell to that genre. I'm going to write about the entire decade because, frankly, that's really the most important and final thing to talk about in this guise. I have also taken my bucket list of books that I want to write in the next 20, and I've now stripped it down to the next 5 years, the books that must get out.
Yeah, there's
so that
a
they
certain,
can have an impact.
I've gotten the same thing happen. I had the visitors jumped all over me. I mean, you wouldn't believe it. Get this new book that I'm working on written, and it's a tremendous challenge. I mean, there's a lot of pressure right now, but
I really feel when you said that, it's the first time I've heard that you had written this book, and I immediately felt, wow, that's a book I've got to get.
Well, good. Folks, you hear that?
Yes. And I mean, I felt it. I'm not like, and I don't usually do that, but my intuition was saying, ah, that's a book I must read.
Well, it's, you know, 30 years of work with the visitors. It's really basically a new vision of reality and also the basis for real communication with them, which is essential if we're going to save ourselves. We've got to have help, and they are there. But right now, communications are not possible. Communications are down at every level, and that can change. And that's what the book is about. That's why it's called A New World.
I have a similar book that I'm also being forced to write that I wasn't even going to think about for 5 years. That now, and it's called Climate Crisis Prophecies, and I'm working on it, and I've been flooded with information. It's the culmination of all the things that I've been watching since 1973, when watching the movie Soylent Green triggered, as I was a junior in high school, triggered this epiphany that I said, this is actually a possible future. You know, despite the B adventure action film that it mostly was,
yeah.
A couple incredible scenes.
There were.
It doesn't matter. For me, the arts have always triggered these epiphanies unexpectedly, and I have been watching this process, and then later, from 1983, 10 years later, began to write and document my views and research into this process. And then just actually in the last few months, I had this realization of this shift of things, and it sounds from just listening to you that, you know, we're both kind of in the messenger field, and
yeah.
But from different angles, and it sounds like you've also had an acceleration, kind of things come into clarity that need to be stated in the next several years.
Well,
while
yeah, because, you know, this thing is falling apart, and
yeah.
You know, all of the violent storms across the center of the United States,
yeah.
Not a word, except there was no warning that this spring would be like this, except in one place, which was on unknowncountry.com's Climate Watch.
Even today, even right now, there's been for the last several days a bronzy sheen that's penetrating the sunlight through the clouds, and I found out that this sheen is from a fire in Siberia. It's thousands of miles away. I saw it. It is absolutely apocalyptic. It is a vast fire that I haven't seen since 2015. And all the weather is looking like it's setting up for the same kind of things that happened in 2015 around here in the Pacific Northwest. And I imagine in a few more days we'll actually be seeing the real fire clouds, because that happened in central Siberia in 2015. And 2015 was the second hottest year on record. So,
yeah, well, you know, we're going to see more and more of these fires. And it just is the case. We went through hell here in California just a few months ago, and this has been very up close and personal to me in a way. I've had friends who have had tremendous damage to their homes in Houston. I've had friends who lost their homes in a tornado in East Texas. I've had friends who were burned out in Malibu. This is really on my mind. But look, we've diverged a little bit, and we're going to take a little break right now, folks. And then when we come back, John is going to lay out exactly what the Nostradamus prophecy that involves Notre Dame is and how it all works. We'll be right back.
Whitley Strieber's nonfiction is magical, powerful, and thought-provoking. From communion to the afterlife revolution, there is no body of work like it in the world. Nothing even approaches it. And not only that, his wonderful fiction, from The Wolfen to his latest novel, New, offers reading and listening entertainment that you will never forget. And where do you find all this in one place? At Strieber.com. That's where. Every Whitley Strieber book available for sale is there. So don't wait. Go to Strieber.com and start exploring. There's only one Whitley, and only one place to find all his work, Strieber.com.
We're talking to John Hogue, his website, HogueProphecy.com. He is once again doing readings, and you might check that out, because John is quite an expert at what he does. And whether it's a hit or a miss, you can be sure of one thing: he is going to try hard on your behalf. Now, John, Notre Dame and Nostradamus, we just started talking about it a few minutes ago. We digressed a little bit. Now let's talk more about the quatrain you found and what it means.
First, very briefly, I want to talk about the one that's been bandied around all over internet, the head of Aries, Jupiter, and Saturn prophecy. I'm sure anybody who's been looking at these memes have been seeing that. That prophecy, in my first article, I take apart what a lot of people have said about it, some like Jessica Adams in the United Kingdom and other people. It really shows how wanting people are who call themselves experts who don't really have any background in the study. So they don't understand that it's an astrological prediction. The first line, and it says, head of Aries, which is in the sign of Aries, Jupiter and Saturn, which implies a Jupiter-Saturn conjunction in Aries, which they all missed. Eternal God, what changes? Nostradamus says. Then the bad times return after a long century. What turmoil in France and Italy? And he's really, it's rare for him to be so editorial in this prophecy. That's why it's a famous one. Now, there's nothing in there about Notre Dame, but what there is in there is a very clear, it's a very rare conjunction, and it happened twice in the 20th century. It happened in 1939 before the onset of World War II, and therefore the bad times that he's talking about returning must happen at the end of a century like World War II, another potential world war, and it happened again in 1999, this conjunction, at the end of what has been called by many historians the long century, the 20th century, because we've packed more experiences in this one century than the previous 19. So that's not about Notre Dame, but because I could not imagine, and I could not imagine this without, I don't project on Nostradamus, but I have also thought, you know, it would be interesting to see if he missed this fire, since he was so attached to that church. I think he didn't. It's very rare when you're a hardcore interpreter of Nostradamus who knows how to do it over 30, 40 years with staying power. You're not so easily saying, oh, this must be about this. Oh, trumpet. He's talking about Trump into this prophecy. It must be about Trump. No, the rest of the prophecy has something to say. And so I'm surprised. I think I might have found something. And it is Quatrain 65 in Century, or Volume 5 of Les Prophéties, the Prophecies of Nostradamus. That's his magnum opus that most people read. And it reads like this. Suddenly arrived, the terror will be great. The affair is hidden by the principal players. And the lady, or the dame, Notre Dame, because lady is dame, in D-A-M-E, the lady in the hot coals will no longer be in sight. She's on fire. Thus, little by little, will the great ones be angered. Now that prophecy, he has a style of dyslexically putting things out of sequence. I switched one line around, and I'll read it again, and it has even more clarity. Suddenly arrived, the terror will be great. The affair is hidden by the principal players. No, hold on. It's a little farther down. It's this one. Suddenly arrived, the terror will be great. And the dame, meaning Notre Dame, in the hot coals will no longer be in sight. The affair is hidden by the principal players. Thus, little by little, will the great ones be angered. Now, what I've come across already by investigating a number of things that are being stated by people of authority, like Benjamin Mouton, who should know, and he was given permission by the man who replaced him after he retired. He said, I've been given permission to talk to National French TV about these issues. So it's like you're getting the French government talking about how they're already saying, before even starting the work, we favor the possibility of a short. But they're talking in thin air. There has been no investigation yet. So for the chief prosecutor of this, as they call him, to be making these statements before a single thing has been investigated shows that they're already trying to bias the narrative. The other thing that I was saying earlier is that there are only two guards in the place. There were no workers working on Notre Dame. And so one cannot, at the time of the fire, so there's no torch or welding going on. The place is, I got videos of what it looks like inside Le Forêt, the forest, which is, it took a whole forest to build all that amazing oak wooden roof. And it's a vast labyrinth, very easy to get lost in there. The security is not that good. And the thing that a lot of mainstream news in France, as well as the rest of the world, is overlooking is there has been all kinds of vandalism and arson going on in the last 18 months across France's 21,000 churches. 875 of them have been vandalized or attempted in arson.
And so, that's not ever... Not a word of that has appeared anywhere. No.
And a big church that's across from the river, the Seine, Saint-Sulpice, was also hit by arson, and the police said it was arson. They firebombed one of the front doors. And it caused a whole lot of smoke to rage inside the dome, and there's videos of it, and that was arson. So we're talking about, and in that week, 11 churches were hit, and so there is a possibility that they're trying to cover up an arson because the thing.
Yeah, and
that,
does the quatrain is anything? I didn't. What does the quatrain suggest regarding that?
Well, it basically, you know, the great, Our Lady, the Great Lady, the Ancient Lady, are the ways, and as I was saying earlier, the ways that they talk metaphorically about churches in the 16th century. So if you look at Dame with the Notre missing, but the Lady as not a person, because I looked at every possible way Nostradamus used Lady and other things in the Old French. And this was the only one that clearly indicated something of, you know, a lady in burnt and hot coils. I remember in 1997 when I looked at it, I said, I have no idea what this is about, so either I can't figure it out or it's about something in the future. The no longer in sight because of the fire. The affair is hidden by the principal players. That means the players could be the people who are going around launching these fires, hoodlums. Maybe they're just hoodlums. Maybe it's just one of those copycats.
You know, there's just so much. France is in a very disturbed state. The Muslim community is so unhappy, and the rank and file French people are too. And, you know, they're demonstrating in the streets. And so, you know, it could be anything.
Well, the other thing too is that I woke up yesterday morning on Easter Sunday with a thought that I don't usually have. I woke up thinking there's been an act of terror somewhere, a big one. And I went, okay, I went off with my day. And then halfway through the day, I checked the news, world news. 200 people in Ceylon, in Sri Lanka, were blown away.
Yeah, it's now up to 300.
Churches. Yeah, they hit like a dozen churches across the country. So here's the thing. With hundreds of people coming back from the fight in the Middle East, hundreds of former ISIS warriors and their wives and things coming back, and coming back to France and other places, one possibility is that it has an Islamic extreme source. The other possibility is that because France has gotten so secular, that it could just be hooligan French young men doing it. It could even be this is. So I'm not like saying this is what it is. And the other thing that I can't help but think, because this man was so even-handed in his concern, this Benjamin Mouton, who's the chief architect before, and he's on the group trying to investigate this. You know, he was so clear and detailed about how where the fire began. There was no working going on. There was no workspace there. So that means no place for electrical equipment to be plugged into his completely updated version of all the electrical system of the cathedral. And yet here was this huge fire that could only have happened if it had enough kindling, enough fuel, like some kind of accelerant to get it so hot that it could make even oak burn at that rate of burning. So that requires some kind of firebomb, some kind of something really big.
And yeah.
And so the danger is that this is going to take some time, and slowly, slowly, if the prophecy is correct.
Linda Moulton Howe has just sent us a video of someone moving around in the roof area of the cathedral, followed by a bright flash. And that's this video is being sent for analysis, because obviously it could be a fake. And I have a pretty good infrastructure, which she uses also, of analysts to look at these videos and see whether or not they're for real. So we'll see. I mean, it could be that if the video is judged to be a real event, then it would seem there was somebody up there, and they either had an accident or did this on purpose.
Yeah.
So
and the,
go ahead.
And the other important thing is that it also could be, as Nostradamus often says in his prophecies, you know, this event, I contend that he saw it, and that it's like a portent of things to come to France, because Nostradamus, you always look for whatever's going on with France, because he sees the future through the French people of the future. So if they're involved, so you always follow the French, not your own country or stuff like that, which is also a great mistake people make in interpreting this. And so the thing is that what happened the following Saturday, the 23rd Saturday in a row, the Gilets Jaunes, the yellow vests, it was the most violent and one of the largest riotous demonstrations of them all, because the people were so angered at this, you know, this myth that Marie Antoinette said, let them eat cake. But this myth has a certain essential fact that the people in power, the 1% that are getting incredibly rich in the European Union in France and are taking their money out of France into the general European Union, there is another thing that's not being reported, that you're going to see major changes in the end of May during the parliamentary elections for the EU, is that the people feel unrepresented, that they're under a technocratic dictatorship. And the people of France, the working people, can't afford to live now. And so what they...
Yeah, there's a tremendous... It's the same thing that's happening all over the world.
Right.
Here in China and...
Time of revolution.
Yeah, it is definitely. Because people are going to start to starve soon. John, we're coming to the end of our time together because we only have a half hour this time around because we're sort of tacking this on to a show that was already recorded because this is a big event and an important event, and I don't want to just pass it by.
I just want to say one thing quickly to finish my
sure,
point.
Sure, go right ahead.
Is that the burning of the church could literally be the beginning of a revolution in France because the people are so angry because a couple handful of billionaires throw billions of euros in 1 or 2 days on this, and the people were saying, hey, what about us?
Yeah, I can understand their anger, too, because the average wage in France is not a living wage anymore.
1,000 euros for some people are living on 1,000 euros, and I've lived in France. It's a very expensive
1,000
place.
Euros a month, he means, by the way, not
yeah,
a year.
Yeah, a month, yeah. And it's not enough.
No. Well, John, thank you so much for being with us, as always, and we will keep up with your work, and John will be back with us in July when we will... give a listen to the developments that have emerged out of what we discussed last January. John Hogue's website is hogueprophecy.com. He is open to doing readings again, so you should go on hogueprophecy.com and explore that.
Yeah, you go to my website, and the first thing you'll see just below the main picture of the first article is online readings with John Hogue, and there's an email there. So contact me there and put in the subject line, Hogue Reading, and I'll give you the information, more information, times, how it's
paid.
Well, what
is the email? Just tell us the email.
Well, the email is hoguebulletin@hogueprophecy.com. That's
okay, so if you're interested in a reading... Email HogueBulletin@HogueProphecy.com and put
Hogue Reading on it.
Hogue Reading on
the subject line.
Right.
So, because I get a lot of emails and I want to be sure I don't miss yours. So and then I will send you the information for the next step and we can arrange a reading.
Okay. Well, John, thank you so much for being with us on Dreamland and we'll revisit in July.
Thank you.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host, and I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening. Listening.